हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम बैक टू द कोर्स करंट रेगुलेटरी रिक्वायरमेंट फॉर कंडक्टिंग क्लिनिकल ट्रायल इन इंडिया। सो दिस इज़ द लास्ट लेक्चर ऑफ फॉर दिस कोर्स। आई होप यू हैव एन्जॉयड ऑल द लेक्चर अप टू द लेक्चर 11 एंड वेल अंडरस्टूड ऑल दिस लेक्चर्स। इवन इफ यू हैव नॉट अंडरस्टूड इट प्रॉपरली एंड इफ यू आर हैविंग सम कंसर्न और सम डाउट, सो we will be addressing this lecture only for your special concern. So this lecture is about the special concerns where we have to take some precautions or what are the special guidelines. So this lecture is about special concern. So the learning objective of this lecture, upon completion of this session, that trainee will be aware of regulatory requirement for vaccines. So these are the product or items of special concerns. So you will be able to know what is vaccine, what are the guidelines, then bioavailability, bioequivalent studies, phytopharmaceuticals, recombinant DNA derived drug product that we call biosimilars, then stem cell and stem cell based product. There is always confusion for the application or regulation of the traditional system medicines, that is Ayush, then radiopharmaceuticals. So let us start with the vaccine, the first concern. As this is a biological product, some changes are there in the drug regulation. So first of all, what is vaccine? Dear friends, we know the vaccines, they are developed from the microorganism and they differ from the normal or routine drugs, as the drugs are being manufactured or synthesized from chemical substances and these are from the microorganisms, hence there is a special concern. A vaccine is a biological preparation that provides active acquired immunity to a particular disease. And as I have said, a vaccine typically contains an agent that resembles a disease causing microorganism and is often made from weakened or killed form of the microbes. These microbes are weakened to their toxicity, or we can use the word attenuation also. So these microbes, it's a toxin or one of its a surface protein are required for the manufacturing of vaccine. The agent stimulates the body's immune system. The vaccine which is prepared, its function through stimulating the body's immune system to recognize the agent as a threat, destroy it, and to further recognize and destroy any of the microorganism associated with that agent that it may encounter in the future. Likewise, it develops a antibody which will remain as a memory, and whenever there is attack by these organisms, then it will provide a immunity. So these are derived from living organism. This organism, ranging from normal or genetically modified organism to fluids or tissues derived from various animals or human sources also. They frequently have complex molecular structure. So in this vaccine product, the important thing to be known is that all vaccines are considered as a new drug. We have seen what is a new drug, what is a drug. So all the vaccines, unlike a drug, they are new drugs. So as it is a new drug, we know that if it is a new drug, for its manufacturing, for its import, it require a clinical trial first, that is safety and efficacy study. And in case of the drug, we have seen that once the drug is approved, then after 4 years it become a old drug. So this is not the case with the vaccines. So the demonstration of safety and efficacy for use in human is essential before it can be approved for import or manufacturing of CDS. So that is the clinical trials are required whenever these vaccines are manufactured. This is because it is from the microorganism and there may be variation from the manufacturer to manufacturer, hence it is always new drug. Let us see what are the rules and regulation related to this biological product. The regulation under drug and cosmetic rules, these are 122A, 122B, 122D and 122E. So, we have seen all these rules. 122E is related to the new drug definition, wherein it has been mentioned that all vaccines and recombinant product are a new drug. Further, the data requirement, it is for the application of new drug for manufacturing or import or to undertake a clinical trial, that has been given in the appendix 1, appendix 1A and 12 of schedule Y. This describes all the information necessary for seeking approval of vaccine along with an application to import or manufacture for market and sell. Now, let us see what are the guidelines and documents we can refer for the approval or to submit the data. We have seen all the guidelines in our lecture 5, still we are here giving the specific documents and guidance for this biological product. These guidelines are available, that is submission, for the submission of clinical trial application for evaluating safety and efficacy. Regarding this, the document is available. Then further, requirement for permission of new drug approval. So, as I have said, it is all time the new drug. So, for the specially this vaccine, the document is there. Then once the product is approved and if there are some changes, then how to apply for the post approval changes. Regarding this, these items, there are the guidelines and documents which we call post approval changes in biological product, quality, safety and efficacy document. Then preparation of quality information for drug submission for new drug approval, biotechnological biological product. This document is also available. The next thing to be concerned is the bioavailability and bioequivalence studies. So, always there is a confusion in clinical trial, bioavailability and bioequivalent studies. Let us see what is means by bioavailability. In general, we can say the rate and extent to which the drug enter into the blood or systematic circulation, and whatever the fraction available in the blood, we can say that is the bioavailable fraction. This can be defined as bioavailability refers to the relative amount of drug from an administered dosage form, whatever the tablet, capsule, the dosage form, which enters the systematic circulation, that is blood, at the rate at which the drug appears in the systemic circulation. So, this is the bioavailability. Now, let us see how the bioequivalence is achieved and what is bioequivalence. Bioequivalence of a drug product is achieved if its extent and rate of absorption are not statistically significantly different from those of the reference product when administered at the same molar dose. It means if we administer the reference product, which is approved one, and the new product, and if we see the amount of that drug product, that is we call concentration, available in the blood circulation, and if these are comparable, then we can say the bioequivalence is achieved and the drug is effective. So, in this, the important to know that for drugs approved elsewhere in the world, so that is approved other than India, and mean to be absorbed systemically, if it is for the systemic absorption, if it goes to the blood circulation, then bioequivalence with the reference formulation which is already approved are required wherever applicable. This study should be conducted under label condition of administration, whatever the label condition. So, under that condition these studies has to be done. Data on the extent of systemic absorption may be required for formulation other than those designed for systemic absorption. The next is evaluation of effect of food on absorption following oral administration should be carried out. So, there is a variation in ethnicity and there is a variation from the population to population. There is variation among the diet habits and the culture. So, the whatever the food is having the effect, that also have to be taken into the consideration while considering the bioequivalence study. Data from dissolution study should also be submitted for all solid dosage form. So, this is a in vitro dissolution study. This study is conducted with a special apparatus which are given in the USP. Dissolution and bioavailability data submitted with new drug application must provide information that ensure BER establishes bioavailability and dosage correlation between the formulations sought to be marketed and those used for clinical trial. So, there should be a correlation or relation between the data of the reference product and the data to be tested. The focus of this BAB studies is on the release of the drug. So, this difference in the efficacy or difference in the bioequivalence is mainly because of the there may be a different manufacturer and they must have added the different excipients which may release or which may not release the active moiety into the blood circulation. So, the focus should be on the release of the drug substance from its dosage form and subsequent absorption into the systemic circulation. Bioavailability studies need to be conducted for oral drug formulation having systemic absorption. Then bioequivalence studies need to be conducted for the comparison of two medicinal product containing the same active substances. It is not like that one drug is having the paracetamol and one drug is having the ciprofloxacin and you have compared both these drugs whether they are entering into the systemic circulation or not. It is not like that. There should be a same active moiety in the both dosage form, that is tablet or paracetamol may be having the different manufacturer or the same manufacturer with a different manufacturing process. All studies should be conducted according to the prescribed guidelines. So, guideline we have seen in lecture 5 also, here also. So, that study should be conducted according to the guidelines. Study data has to be submitted with the application for new drugs. So, this is one of the requirement that bioavailability, bioequivalence study data has to be submitted along with the application for the clinical trial. Let us see the what are the methods to achieve this bioequivalence or to determine the bioequivalence and bioavailability studies. The first one is comparative BAB studies. As I have said, there is a reference product which is approved one whose efficacy and whose the concentration available in blood is known. So, that have to be compared with the test drug. So, that is the comparative BAB study. Sometimes one or more metabolite is also measured in an accessible biological fluid such as plasma, blood and urine. So, if the metabolites are prominent, then the concentration of that metabolite that also have to be determined to see the efficacy of this test drug. Then comparative pharmacodynamic studies are also carried out for seeing the bioequivalence. Comparative clinical trial, in this the if two drugs are given and we have to see the pharmacological effect. If the effects are similar or equivalent, then we can see the equivalence is achieved. Then one more method, that is in vitro dissolution test. So, this does not involve any animals or the human participant. It is a in vitro dissolution. It is carried out through using an apparatus where the biological fluid or which simulate the biological fluids are the used, like SCL and other water are used, wherein the concentration of the drug is maintained and the comparison has been made. The next atom of concern is that recombinant DNA derived vaccines and biological products. So, this is also very important. DNA, that is rDNA derived vaccines and biological product, we call it as a biosimilar. Let us first see what is mean by recombinant DNA. DNA, we know that deoxyribonucleic acid, and recombinant DNA is a molecule of DNA that has been modified either through genetic recombination or through laboratory techniques. So, genetically modified DNA for the specific purpose, we call it genetic engineering also. So, that is a recombinant DNA. Let us see what is a biosimilar. So, this is the, according to USFDA, a biosimilar is a biological product that is highly similar to approved reference biological product, notwithstanding minor differences in clinically inactive component, and for which there are no clinically meaningful differences between the biological product and the reference product in terms of the safety, purity and potency of the product. So, this biosimilar, these are the product which are comparatively similar with respect to the quality, safety and efficacy, all these specification with the approved product. A similar biologic, so this is important to know, because we have seen in the our guideline that biosimilar guideline has been revised in 2016 and they have made certain changes. A similar biologic can only be developed against an authorized reference biological that has been approved using a complete data package in India. So, once it is approved, then the similar biologic can be approved. However, one change in the revised guideline is that in case where the reference biological is not authorized in India, it should have been approved, licensed, marketed in ICH country. Even though if it is earlier, it should have to be in the country, that is in India. But now the change has been made. If it is available in the ICH country, then that is also okay, one can develop a biosimilar. So, this replaces the previous requirement of it should have been licensed and marketed for at least 4 years with significant safety and efficacy data. So, once it become 4 years, completed 4 years, it becomes old drug, then after that the applicant has to be applied for the biosimilar. It was earlier there, but now with this change, this has been made possible. If the drug, that is biosimilar, available in ICH country, then biosimilar can be developed. Another important addition is that the similar biologic must now meet acceptable level of safety, efficacy and quality to ensure public health in accordance with international guideline, that is guideline developed by the WHO. Now, the data requirement for clinical trial application, beside the information submitted in the preclinical application, the applicant has to submit application for conduct of clinical trial as per the CDSCO guidance for industry 2008. So, in 2008, the guidance document has been published, which is available in the site. So, according to that has to be applied. The quality data submitted should indicate that there are no differences in critical quality attribute and that all key quality attribute, that is KQAs, are well controlled in order to allow the initiation of clinical evaluation. So, these are the guidelines related to the rDNA derived product and the biosimilars. Guideline on similar biologics, that is regulatory requirement for marketing authorization in India by DBT and CDSCO. So, this was guideline earlier for 2012, now it has been revised in 2016. The changes we have seen already. Drugs and Cosmetic Act rule thereunder for manufacture, sale, import and export, this also has to be referred. Then storage of hazardous microorganism, genetically engineered organism, cells modified under Environment Protection Act 1986 and rule thereunder 1989. this also has to be referred for the storage. Then recombinant DNA safety guidelines 1990 by DBT. Guidelines for generating preclinical and clinical data for rDNA vaccine, diagnostic and other biologics. These are the guidelines developed by DBT in 1999. Then guideline and handbook for institutional biosafety committee. These are also developed by the DBT in 2013. Preparation of QMS information for new drug approval. So, all these products are new drug, we know every time it is new drug. Biotechnological biological product by CDSU in 2016. Then the document that is CDSU guidance for industry 2008. Let us see which are the committees involved. So, we have seen in case of the new drug, the subject expert committee, apex committee, TAC committee. So, apart from these committees, again for the biological, there are some special bodies, or we can say the special committees are there, which are having a different roles to play here. Let us see one by one. RCGM, it is a review committee for genetic manipulation. This is under Department of Biotechnology and is responsible for authorizing import export for research and development and review of data up to preclinical evaluation. So, up to the preclinical studies and for the R&D studies, whatever the data that is evaluated by the review committee for genetic manipulation, which is under DBT. Then another committee, that is Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee, GEAC. The function of this committee will see the, and it also under the Ministry of Environment and Forest for review and approval of activities involving large scale use of genetically engineered organism. It is for the, actually it is for the field purposes, whatever the genetically engineered RDNA is using and product thereof in R&D, industrial production, environmental release. If it is for environmental release and R&D purposes, then this committee review the data. CDSCO, we have seen that it is a central licensing authority and this is under Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. It is mainly responsible for grant of import export license, clinical trials, new drug approval permission, then permission for manufacturing and marketing. So, once it is approved, then it goes to the state licensing authority and the state licensing authority gives the license for manufacturing and market. These are the some examples of recombinant DNA product, humulin and other which are used for diabetic and other indications. Next topic of concern is phytopharmaceutical, as this was not earlier there in the Drug and Cosmetic Act and rules there under. So, we have given here the phytopharmaceuticals. We have seen this phytopharmaceutical has been added in new drug definition in 2015. Let us see what is phytopharmaceutical. It is a purified and standardized fraction with a defined minimum 4 bioactive phytochemical compound. So, this is a extract of the herbal plant or the extract we can say of the medicinal plant that should have at least 4 bioactive phytochemical compounds, and that compounds are qualitatively and quantitatively should be assessed. And this is used for the, we know that the intention of the drug to for the treatment, diagnosis, prevention and mitigation of drug disease and disorder in human being or in animal. We have seen in drug definition, new drug definition. So, it is also a drug, only the thing is that it is a phytopharmaceutical and it is extract of a medicinal plant and should have minimum 4 bioactive compounds. One more thing that is to be considered that this product does not include administration by parenteral route. So, this is also required to be keep in mind. Let us see what are the data requirement for the regulatory approval. So, the data requirement for the clinical trial, new drug manufacture, it is given in schedule Y appendix 1B, and this schedule by appendix 1b has been divided into the two part. The first part related to the data to be submitted by the applicant. It means whatever the data available in the market or elsewhere. So, whatever the data available in country or globally, that has to be submitted by the applicant, that is data to be submitted by applicant. It consists of brief description of this phytopharmaceutical drug, published literature including information of plant or product, then whatever the data available for the clinical trial, human or clinical pharmacological data, published data. Then part 2 is related to the data generated by the applicant, means whatever the data generated by applicant himself, that is manufacturing, cultivations. So, that has to be submitted according to this, we will see one by one. Identification, authentication and source of plant used for extraction and fractionation, that is taxonomy, morphology and anatomical description, the plant whatever going to be used. So, the data for that has to be given. Then process for extraction and subsequent fractionation and purification, whatever the procedure used for manufacture of the drug from this plant source or from the extract of this medicinal plant, that has to be submitted. Formulation of phytopharmaceutical drug applied for. So, whatever the formulation proposed to manufacture, like a tablet, capsule, other than parenteral we have seen. So, that formulation required to be submitted. Then manufacturing processes of formulation, how to manufacture, what are the processes involved, that detail have to be given. Stability data and safety and pharmacological information. So, this data also required to be generated and submitted. In addition to that, again the human studies data, then confirmatory clinical trial, that is phase 3, regulatory status, whether it is available in any other countries, whether it is for what purpose it has been indicated, whether it has been banned, prohibited, withdrawn or any adverse reaction with this phytopharmaceutical, that detailed regulatory status has to be submitted. Same is the marketing information, then post marketing surveillance and any other relevant information. Next topic for the concern is the stem cell and stem cell based product. So, let us see first what are the stem cells. Stem cells are undifferentiated biological cells with a capacity for self renewal, proliferation and differentiation into many different types of functional cell. Stem cells are, these are the cells which are having the potential to cultivate, potential to cultivate or for the proliferation or the self growth. So, that we call the stem cells. And the stem cell products, this the term stem cell product, that is SCBP, it is used to refer to product intended to be administered to a patient that contain or are derived from stem cells. So, at present the therapeutic treatment by stem cell as provided in the NGSCR, that is National Guideline for Stem Cell Research, are considered as established therapies, or we can say these are the standard of care, and rest of the therapies come under the developmental or research categories. Let us see what is the regulatory requirement and licensing procedure. So, as a, like a drug, the manufacturer importer of the product shall have to apply in form 44, we have seen for the new drug, form 44 is required, along with the requisite data as specified under Drug and Cosmetic Act, that is Act and Rules, that is Schedule Y, according to that data have to submitted. And this data is required in case of clinical trial permission, new drug permission, and once these clinical trial are conducted based on satisfactory result in the new drug permission, the new drug permission is issued by CDSCO in form 46, form 45. So, once the clinical trial permission has been given, the clinical trial conducted, and if the results are satisfactory, then permission can be given. So the difference here is that, like a drug, this permission is given in consultation with one of the committee. We call it CBBTDEC, that is Cellular Biology Based Therapeutic Drug Evaluation Committee. So this committee is there in consultation with the CDSCO officer. They review all the protocol, they review all the clinical trial report, and after recommendation, permission is granted. So after getting this new drug permission, the manufacturer or applicant has to obtain license to manufacture for sale and distribution. So for this, he has to apply to the concerned state licensing authority. If it is in Gujarat, then he has to apply to the Gujarat state licensing authority, or if it is in Andhra, then the Andhra Pradesh licensing authority. The license to manufacture in form 28 under D&C rules. So license will be issued in form 28. Further, in case of import, the applicant has to obtain registration certificate in form 41 followed by import license in form 10. If it is the case of the import and registration, the after registering the site, then has to take the import license, that is form 10, from the central licensing authority. So in this regard, the ICMR has also developed a guideline. These are the national guidelines for stem cell research. Let us have a look of this guideline. So the 2017 guidelines, these reiterate that any stem cell used in patient other than that for hematopoietic stem cell. So this is not covered here, hematopoietic stem cell reconstitution for approved indication is investigational at present, and accordingly any stem cell used in patient must only be done within the purview of an approved and monitored clinical trial with the intent to advance science and medicine, and it must not be offered as a therapy. In accordance with this stringent definition, every use of stem cell in patient outside an approved clinical trial is unethical and shall be considered as a malpractice. The guideline also provides important definitions for and elaborates upon level of manipulation, if it is a minimum manipulation, maximum manipulation, when to require the clinical trial permission, then category of research, that is permissible, biosimilar, restrictive or prohibitive, that also given in this guideline. Then what are the ideal manufacturing processes to be followed, then release criteria, among others, these are given in this guideline. The important thing to know is that the guidelines do not apply to research using non-human stem cells and their derivatives. So it is not for the non-human stem cell, like a plant cell, animal cell. So this is only for the human stem cells. Further, these do not apply to use of hematopoietic stem cell. We have seen this guideline are not applicable for the hematopoietic stem cells for treatment of various hematological, immunological and metabolic disorder, since these have already been established as a standard of care. Further, the protein rich plasma and autologous chondrocytes implantations does not fall under the purview of this guideline, as they are also have been categorized as other cell based application and not stem cell transplantations. So, which guidelines to be referred and which where the requirements are given? The first, our statute, that is Drug and Cosmetic Act 1940 and rules 1945, these also require to be followed, because whenever there is a drug, that is enforced through the Drug and Cosmetic Act, and these rules to be followed. Then National Guideline for Stem Cell Research 2017, as what we have seen in our previous slide. Draft guidance document for regulatory approval of stem cell and cell based product, that is SCCP, published on 30 December 2013 by CDSCO. So this document is also available on our website. Coming to the next topic for the concern, that is a traditional system of medicines. As we know, the traditional system, Ayurvedic, Siddha, Yunani, there is always confusion whether these are the drug, whether these are regulated or not regulated. If regulated, what are the requirement, which books to be followed, what guidelines to be followed. So let us see what are these traditional systems. Ayush, as we know, it is Ayurvedic, Siddha and Unani medicines, and these are regulated by Department of Ayush. There is one Department of Ayush under the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. So this department and also the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare's office, that is CDSCO, this department regulates the whatever the drug from the Ayurvedic, Siddha and Unani. Some of the parts regulated by the CDSCO, State Licensing Authority, but this is the special department in the ministry to look after this Ayush. So, in the Drug and Cosmetic Act also the provisions are given. So, in the chapter 4A, we have seen it is related to the provision related to the Ayurvedic, Siddha and Unani drugs. So, the provision related to the permission, sale, distribution, manufacturing, who has to inspect the facilities, all these given under these provisions. And as we have seen in the act, there are two schedules, schedule first and schedule second. So, the first schedule of this act is for this Ayurvedic, Siddha and Unani system. Then Drug and Cosmetic Rule 1945, in which part 16 describe manufacture for sale of Ayurvedic including Siddha or Unani drugs. So, this part is also dealing with the manufacturing of Ayurvedic drug. Then part 16 is for approval of institution for carrying out test on Ayurvedic, Siddha and Unani drugs and raw material used in their manufacturer. So, this is for the institution which are dealing with the testing of the Ayurvedic product or Siddha product. So, this part 16 is for approval of that type of institutions. Part 17 is for labeling, packing and limit of alcohol in Ayurvedic, Siddha and Unani. So, how to label this product, this is given in this part. Then part 19 is for standard of Ayurvedic, Siddha and Unani drugs. So, in the part 19, the standard of these drugs have been given. So, until now we have seen about the ASU drug, that is Ayurvedic, Siddha and Unani. So, homeopathy has been slightly separated from this, and the rules regulation given in these parts. Part 6A, it related to the part 6A, that is it is the part of the drug and cosmetic rules, and it is related to the sale of homeopathic drug. Then part 7A, it deals with the manufacture for sale or for distribution of homeopathic medicine. Then part 7A is related to the labeling conditions of this homeopathic medicines. Packing is also given in this part. Coming to the next topic for the concern is a radioactive material and the X-rays. So, whether the permission is required or not required, then again which bodies, committees are involved. So, first of all, for the radioactive material, if it comes under the definition of drug, that is if it is for diagnosis, treatment, mitigation, then it is a drug, and if it is a drug, we know that regulatory permission need to be taken. Appropriate training is necessary in handling radioactive substances. So, for the manufacturing and handling, the appropriate training is required. So, trained people should be there. The things to know, that in this case of the radioactive material, the no objection is required from the BARC, that is Bhabha Atomic Research Center. So, we have seen in biosimilar the various committees like CBB, TDC, RCGM and other committees are involved. For the Ayurvedic product, we have seen there is a separate department like Ayush in under the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. Likewise, for this radioactive material, the NOC from the BARC is required. Then here the concern is that radiation exposure must be within permissible limit. So, whatever the limit prescribed, the exposure should be within that limit. pregnancy need to be rule out. Then radiation guideline must be followed if death occurs with the radiation implant. Coming to the last, that is special concern of medical device and in vitro diagnostic kits. So, you can refer the medical device and in vitro diagnostic kit for it, the medical device rule 2018-2017 effective from the 2018, and we are having a separate course that is a requirement for the conduct of clinical trial permission for the medical device and diagnostics. So, in that course, that is course 2, you will come across all these medical devices and what are the requirement for in vitro diagnostic kits. So, here we are not going to see this. So, let us have the recap. Some questions I will give to you and you have to answer. Under which gazette notification CDSCO regulate phytopharmaceuticals? So, the answer for this gazette notification number 918, GSR 918, and it is published on 30/11/2015. The next question, what are biosimilar drugs? The answer is RDNA technology derived drugs. So, biosimilar are the RDNA technology derived drug compared with innovators formulation and having same specification, that is quality, safety, efficacy. Then what is SCBP? You have to tell the full form of SCBP. So, SCBC is a stem cell based product. The last question, that is what is AYUSH? AYUSH. So, the AYUSH is Ayurvedic, Unani, Siddha and Homeopathy. So, we have seen the department under Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. This is a traditional system of medicines. Let us have brief summary of this lecture. So, in this lecture what we have seen the special concern, the product of special concern, that is vaccine, recombinant DNA. Then we have seen the phytopharmaceuticals, the special concern studies, that is bioavailability and bioequivalent studies we have seen. Then the most important, we have seen the stem cell products, stem cell based product. Then traditional system of medicine, that is Ayurvedic, Siddha and Unani and homeopathic system. And we have seen the radioactive materials, what are the requirement for that. So, this is about all the lecture 12. I hope you have enjoyed all the 12 lectures and understood the concept, whatever the concerns were with you. So, that has been addressed here. So, till the further, enjoy and all the best. Thank you.